Halo, assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. How are you, everyone?
You, sir.
Okay, good. Nice to see you again. The National Roy, Alfati, Dara, Nadia, Periadi, Rayusri, and Shafitri. Okay. While we are waiting for your friends to join with our class today, I would like to directly show you the syllabus. Okay, so this is our syllabus for today. Now let me see. Okay, here it is. The syllabus is actually, we have discussed about English poetry studies, what is poetry, and then types of poetry, poetry and literary devices. We have talked about figurative language, imagery, diction, and then we have talked about poetry, especially dealing with these British poets and American poets, okay? So now we move forward to timeline of American poetry. Karena background saya dulu pernah studi di Amerika, jadi we focus on this one for today. Kita fokus ke sini. American poets in 1800s, tahun 1800-an. Next week, we will talk about American poets, but poets who were born around 1900s, sekitar tahun 1900-an. And I will pick up one example, Ralph Waldo Emerson, in the following week. And Emily Dickinson and Frank O'Hara for the next 2 weeks. So here it is. This is the source that I show you that we are going to use. Can you see this book? Bisa dilihat slide-nya ya?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this is the book, the Oxford Book of American Poetry. This book, collection of writing in this book were chosen, edited by David Lehman and the associate editors John Brand. It was published in Oxford University Press in 2006. So this is the book about American poetry, as you can see. Before we proceed further, let me read you this introduction. Baca dulu introduction-nya yang satu paragraf ini. The past that foreign, okay. Instead of me reading it, because you are the one who are learning about poetry, so I would like you to read, anyone who would love to read this for us, this first paragraph, anyone? Or I just pick up your name if you, okay, Jonathan Elroy, you want to read this? Okay, go ahead, go on.
Yeah. The past that foreign country will do things differently is neither a fixed entity nor a finished narrative, but a changing landscape of the mind where travelers come and go. Talking of Michelangelo, Hamlet, T.S. Eliot, and much else less lofty. It might be that what we call the present divines itself in the disagreements we have about the past and the complicated negotiations we undertake to resolve our differences. This means at bottom that virtually all events, periods, tendencies, and climatenses. This means at bottom, I'm sorry, climatenses, climate of opinion are subject to continual resentment and revision. New facts come to light. Old testimony comes into question. Our belief system changes, and we need to adjust our understanding of history to bring it in line with our governing assumptions. And so, for example, a story once held to be true in the sense that it actually happened is modified into a legend or fiction that might still be true, but only in some attenuated and entirely different sense.
Okay, good, Jonathan, all right. Thank you for reading that for us. So it says that in the past, jadi masa lalu, foreign country where they do things differently, ini. Jadi tidak begitu fixed, yeah, or there is no finished narrative, tapi ada changing landscape, ada perubahan-perubahan. Of the mind where travelers come and go, jadi datang dan pergi. Seperti Michelangelo, Hamlet, T.S. Eliot, and much else less of Tina. So the point in this subject is that here, this is the most provoking thoughts. This means at bottom that virtually all event, jadi semua kejadian, periode, yang di dalam konteks puisi ini, tendencies and climates of opinion ini maksudnya pendapat-pendapat yang berbeda, are subject to continual. Harus ini berada di bawah reassessment, continual ini pengulangan ya, berarti pengujian kembali secara berkelanjutan dan revisi perbaikan fokusnya ya. So this is what it says. And so for example, a story once held to be true, sebuah cerita held to be true benar in the sense that it actually happened. Kalau dia benar-benar terjadi, dimodifikasi menjadi sebuah legenda atau fiksi yang bisa menjadi benar, tapi hanya but only in some attenuated entirely different sense. Tapi mungkin sense atau frasa atau pendekatan itu berbeda dalam hal memahami yang true tadi. Now that's the key point of that right here. So go on and on, as you can see, the principle of continual change applies not only to say, for example, World War I, Perang Dunia Pertama, but even some monuments of unaging intellect, seperti William Butler Yeats called them in Sailing to Byzantium, and so on and so forth. Okay, so this is historinya, yeah. Nah, kita lihat di sini American poet, salah satunya ada Eliot. Eliot's own poetry illustrates the point a little less hyperbolically. As a result of Eliot's persuasive argumentation, his perceived authority and his uncanny ability to pluck superb lines dari original konteksnya dan menggunakan lines barisan tersebut secara sebagai epigraph ke dalam puisi atau kutipan yang embedded within poems yang ada di dalam puisi tersebut. Dan itu terjadi pada abad ke-17, seperti John Donne dan Andrew Marvell, When Sky High in the Early. Jadi John Donne dan Andrew Marvell ini meniru gayanya si Eliot, T.S. Eliot, yang mereka terkenal pada awal abad ke-20. Nah, seperti ini yang kemarin pernah kita baca ya di kelas, The Stock of the Romantic Stalwart Percy Bysshe Shelley Plummeted and Has Never Fully Recovered. Okay. Kemudian tradisi English lyric poetry from the Renaissance, jadi ada namanya Renaissance, ke tahun 1900-an, look different pada tahun 1940 dibandingkan tahun 1910. Nah, sebagai pembandingan secara anthologies dated in those years would attest. Jadi secara sejarah puisi Amerika dan Inggris itu dia berkembang terus, this is very different sense and insinuation. Nah, sekarang kita lihat, so this is the introductions just to lead you to the understanding of the American poetry. Contoh misalnya begini, because the poems have power, jadi puisi ini memiliki kekuatan, because they have genius, they can speak to us with uncanny presence, seperti Whitman's, karya Whitman's yang berjudul Crossing Brooklyn Ferry. It avails not, time nor place, distance avails not. I'm with you, you men and women of a generation, or ever so many generations hence. Hold on, I wrote this. This is you feel when you look on the river and sky, so I felt. Just as any of you is one of a living crowd, I was one of a crowd. Just as you refreshed by the gladness of the river and the bright flow, I was refreshed. Just as you stand and lean on the rail, yet hurry with a stiff current, I stood yet was hurried. Just as you look on the numberless mast of ships and the thick-stemmed pipes of steamboats, I looked. Jadi, coba you perhatikan ini pola dia menulis puisi. Jadi berbeda ya, ditulis oleh Walt Whitman, di judulnya Crossing Brooklyn Ferry. Diawali dengan ini, it avails not. Kemudian diulangi lagi di bagian barisan akhir, avails not. I'm with you, you men and women of generation. Just as you feel, I felt. Just any of you is one of I was one of a crowd. Jadi pengulangan di sini. Just as you are refreshed, I was refreshed. Just as you stand and lean, I was hurried. Ini ada hurry. Just as you look on the numberless mass of ships, I looked. So the language changes, styles go in and out of favor. The poets of a new generation resurrect the deceased visionary who toiled in the dark. Jadi puisi-puisi American ini dia berevolusi, kalau bisa saya bilang ya, dari bentuk struktur, penyampaian makna, dan juga vocabulary yang digunakan dalam puisi tersebut. So according to this book, karena kita fokus American poets yang di tahun 1800, so I would like, okay, hold on, I'd like to view, okay, this one, the contents. So you see, this is in 1612 until 1672. Poet pertama adalah Anne Bradstreet, ini, and then the second one is Edward Tyler. And then di tahun 1752, okay, before that, I'd like to make sure, apakah kita 1800 ya, abad ke 1800. So this is very old, and I would like to come to this one, okay? Okay, 1800-an, this is, you can read this, for example, Edward Taylor, Philip Freneau, kemudian On the Emigration to American Peopling the Western Country. Jadi pada tahun ini, Amerika ini ada terkenal American Dreams karena banyak emas waktu itu. Phyllis Wheatley, On Being Brought from Africa to America. Nah, ini berarti dia punya sejarahnya slavery, perbudakan ini. Jadi, being brought dari Afrika ke Amerika. To the Right Honorable William Earl of Dartmouth. Ada juga American Poet pada tahun 1754-1812, yaitu Joel Barlow, dengan judul puisinya The Hasty Pudding Canto One. Francis Scott Key, Clement Moore in 1779 to 1863, Fitz Greene Halleck from Fanny in 1790 to 1867, William Cullen Bryant, ini yang lahir tahun 1754 dan wafat pada 1878. Ini sonnet to an American painter departing for Europe. So there is, at this, during these years, there was a strong connection between American and Europe. England, Wales, Scotland, even Germany, Perang Dunia I, Perang Dunia II, ini periodenya. And now we would like to see this one, Ralph Waldo Emerson. Ini salah satu beberapa judul dari karya Ralph Waldo Emerson. Ralph published a letter, Concord Hymn, Each and All, Water, Light, The Roderer, The Snowstorm, Hamatria, Fable, O Day, Inscribed to W.H. Channing, Give All to Love, Bacchus, Brahma, and Days. I'm not quite sure, but Ralph Waldo Emerson was known to have a sort of emotional conflict when he wrote this poetry, but you can search more about this one. And then we have Henry Wadsworth Longfellow in 1807-1882. The Bridge, The Fire of Driftwood, The Jewish, okay, ini Jewish, Jewish ini adalah Yahudi. So it's very, it's quite interesting for you to understand the context of during this era. And then My Lost Youth, Paul Revere's Right, and The Tide Rises, The Tide Falls. And then we continue to have John Greenleaf Whittier. Jadi masih laki-laki ya. Ralph Waldo Emerson, Henry Wadsworth Longfellow, John Greenleaf Whittier, with the title of his works were For Righteousness' Sake, Telling the Bees, Barbara Frietchie, What the Birds Say. Oliver Wendell Holmes. We have also Edgar Allan Poe. Kita pilih yang mana di silabus kali ini? Ini Ralph Waldo Emerson. Okay, so we will focus on Ralph next after these two things. Emily Dickinson, Jones Very, and then we have Henry David Thoreau, Julia Ward Howe, The Battle Hymn of the Republic, So you can see ada James Russell Lowell and Walt Whitman. Ini yang cukup ini ya. Walt Whitman ini di eranya memang cukup terkenal. Dia meniru dari mengembangkan karya puisi Amerika sebelumnya. And then we have Herman Melville. Ini juga dia Herman Melville ini juga penulis novel. Pernah dengar film Moby Dick? Kisah cerita Moby Dick yang
pernah Pak?
Moby Dick pernah ya? Yang ya, ini pernah. Yang kalau sudah dibawakan ke dalam film dia ke laut bertemu dengan ikan paus besar.
Paus.
Ya. Yang yes, dimainkan sir. Oleh Chris Hemsworth ya.
Yes, sir.
Nah, ya nih. Ini ada The Maldive Shark. Jadi kisahnya itu dia itu novelnya itu Moby Dick. It's very interesting if you have read the story. Herman Melville, and then we have Frederick Goddard Kerman in 1821. Ada Doug Fenschedder. Kalau bahasa puisi ini di tahun-tahun ini masih kental sense of bahasa Inggrisnya yang menyerap dari Eropa dan juga Anglo-Saxon. Dan juga ada pengaruh dari beberapa biblical expression. And then nih I bisa Frederick Goddard menggunakan kata I di dalam judul puisinya juga bisa. Henry Timrod Charleston. And then ini juga nanti kita akan bahas Emily Dickinson. Emily Dickinson adalah karakter pertama wanita yang menjadi American poet pada 1830-1840. Kalau masih nanti misalnya you tertarik untuk meneliti di bidang sastra, autobiografi misalnya, ini semua puisinya ini diteliti ini untuk memahami esensi dari pesan yang dimiliki oleh Emily Dickinson. Dan itu sangat menarik. Success is counted switches. Nanti kita akan lihat ini salah satu contoh dari success is counted switches. Banyak orang yang mengutip Emily Dickinson. Kemudian ada Emma Lazarus. Emma Lazarus, and then we have Edwin Markham, The Man with the Who, America the Beautiful, and then we have Ernest Lawrence Thayer. Terus di 1800 masih banyak ini Edgar Lee Masters. We have Edwin Arlington Robinson. Ini dari namanya ada pengaruh dari British Robinson. British Robinson ini misalnya karya waktu skripsi saya meneliti tentang ini. Ini judulnya apa nih? Trosila Robinson Crusoe by Daniel Defoe. Ini novel tentang kisah perjalanan dia ke terdampar di sebuah pulau kanibal yang sudah dimainkan menjadi beberapa film. Kemudian we have Stephen Crane, nah James Waldo Johnson, Paul Laurence Dunbar, Robert Frost. Nah, kalau untuk Robert Frost ini contohnya. Okay, this is Robert Frost, A Collection of Poems Robert Frost. Ini I download it online, ada di online jadi so I do not buy it. Seperti ini Robert Frost. Robert Frost dia lahir 1874, meninggal 1963 ya. Kemudian nih kontennya, as you can see, it's very interesting. Jadi puisi ini memang bentuknya seperti ini ya, baris-baris pendek. Tapi kalau memang kita membacanya secara semiotika, secara sintaksis dan juga makna leksikal dan makna dialektikal dan makna historis yang di dalam puisi itu, we can see different ways of how poets try to convince a certain message through their words. Okay, ini salah satu karya Robert Frost yang diterbitkan pada tahun 1800-an ya. For once and something. So it's if you, nah ini panjang ini ya puisi. Ini juga puisi ini. Ada tanda kutip ini. When was I ever anything but kind to him? Jadi ada beberapa yang poets itu yang background-nya American or some European. Satu atau dua yang memiliki kecenderungan platonic relationship among men or between mostly men. Robert Frost, and then we have Emmy Lowell, Gertrude Stein. Ini cukup terkenal. Dia dari nama ada pengaruh dari Prancis. And then we have Timbal Stickney, Adelaide Chapsey, Carl Sandburg, Wallace Stevens. Wow, Wallace Stevens, banyak karya-karyanya ini. And then we have Angelina Wilt, Grimke. And then Mina Loy, William Carlos Williams. We have Ezra Pound. She's also famous at the time. And then Eleanor Wiley, Hilda Doolittle, Robinson Jeffers, Marianne Moore, T.S. Eliot, ini dia, T.S. Eliot, very famous in American context. Bahkan T.S. Eliot ini sampai sekarang di beberapa universitas di Amerika Serikat sedang dikaji karya-karyanya yang sangat insightful dan memiliki makna yang bisa dibawa ke beberapa konteks zaman ya. Yang T.S. Eliot, kemudian John Crowley Ransom, Conrad Aiken, we have Claude McKay, Archibald MacLeish. Ini juga Archibald MacLeish, Ars Poetica ini sangat terkenal kalau you mau belajar tentang filsafat bahasa Inggris, ini perlu dibaca ini. Kemudian What Any Lovers Learns, Edna St. Vincent Millay, Samuel Greenberg, Dorothy Parker, E.E. Cummings, Charles Resnikov, ini ada pengaruh dari Rusia. Kemudian H. Phelps Putnam, Bessie Smith, Jan Toomer, Mark Van Doren, Louis Bogan, John Will Wright, Stephen Vincent Bennett, Melvin B. Tolson, Leonie Adams, Hart Crane. Then we have Alan Tate, Ivo Winters, Sterling A. Brown. So ini yang terakhir, Alan Tate. Nah, dari Ivo Winters, ini sudah masuk American Poets yang lahir di tahun 1900-an. Jadi sudah terkategori beda mereka ini yang apanya. So we take one. Jadi banyak ini yang bisa kalian baca dari American Poets dari buku ini. Kalau nggak salah ini bisa salah satu teman you kalau nggak salah sudah mendownloadnya waktu itu ya. Ini bukunya The Oxford Book of American Poetry by David Lehman. So I'd like to open one, salah satu yang American Poets tahun 1800-an ini. Kita buka misalnya karya Herman Melville. Nah, ini dia. So this is what it says. Okay. Nah, Herman Melville 1819-1891. So anyone who would love to read this paragraph for us? Silakan yang mau baca.
I want to read it, sir.
Oh, you want to read? Okay, you can help your friend. Maybe. Sure.
Failure is the true test of greatness, Herman Melville wrote. It was a test fate compelled him to meet. His first novel was success by Moby Dick, but Moby Dick, 1851, had an enthusiastic reception and a year later was savaged by the crisis. But the critics, I'm sorry. Herman has taken to writing poetry, wrote his wife in 1859. He collected his poems about the civil war in battle pieces and aspects of the war, 1866. In July 1863, he wrote The House Top, when Irish mobs in the New York City, reuniting against military conscription, lynched black men and hanged them from lamppost. With men in such form as Reconciliation and Figure Strange One, kept on the field one night. Wrote about soldiers and ones close up. Melville wrote about the great historic tragedy from a distance. In Call Me Ishmael, 1947, a personal referee based on academic undertaking, Charles also wrote, the man made a mess of things. He got a bell up with Christ. He made a white marriage. He had one son die of tuberculosis. The other shot himself. He only wrote his own space once, Moby Dick. He had to be wild or he has nothing in particular. He had to go fast, like in America, or he was all torpor. Half horse, half alligator. A white marriage is an unconsummated one. After the pleasure party, a late poem presents Melville's reflection of the relation between man and woman. In his copy of Emerson's essays, where Emerson had written, "Trust men and they will be true to you," Melville wrote in the margin, God help the poor fellow who squares in his life according to this.
Okay, thank you, Jonathan. So it says, see, Jonathan Herman Melville ini membuat karya berjudul Moby Dick di tahun 1851. So this is very interesting when he said, Herman has taken to writing poetry, wrote his wife in 1859. Jadi 8 tahun setelah Moby Dick muncul, baru kemudian dia menulis puisi ini menurut keterangan dari istrinya. Dan dia menuliskan puisi. Nah ini ingat, tadi meskipun itu puisi, tapi tidak pernah lepas dari konteks puisi tersebut published atau lahir ya. Di sini pada waktu itu 1863 katanya dia menulis puisi tentang Civil War, perang sipil, pada karyanya Battle Pieces and Aspects of the War pada tahun 1866. Dia menulis The Housetop ini pada waktu terjadinya mobs dari orang-orang Irlandia pada yang terjadi di kota New York dan menyebabkan ketegangan antara masyarakat dengan militer, conscription, lynch black men and hang them. Jadi malah justru terjadi militer tersebut pressure terhadap orang-orang berkulit hitam apalagi yang laki-lakinya dan hang them ini maksudnya memang agak spooky ya di zaman itu, langsung menggantung. Jadi dihidup-hidup digantung seperti itu, hang them from lampposts. Lampposts itu dari tempat-tempat mereka berada. Whitman menulis dalam puisi Reconciliation dan Pedro Strange I Kept on the Field One. Jadi, Knight wrote Soldiers and Wounds, close up. Okay? Great Historic Tragedy. Jadi pada tahun ini, dia membuat karya-karya memang lebih berkaitan dengan konteks yang terjadi pada waktu itu. Nah, ini dinamakan dengan pendekatan historis terhadap penulis puisi atau poet, dan juga pendekatan historis di dalam memaknai kandungan makna yang ada dalam karya puisi American Poet. Ini salah satunya Herman Melville. Itu sebabnya selalu kalau penulis puisi atau sastrawan, selalu nama mereka dan juga tahun lahir, dan kalau misalnya titik-titik berarti masih hidup. Nah, kalau ini kan berarti wafat tahun 1891. And then dia juga menulis tentang white marriage. Nah, jadi pernikahan orang kulit putih. Kira-kira Herman Melville ini orang kulit putih atau kulit hitam? Herman Melville. Ya, di konteksnya nih. He had to go fast like an American or he was all torpor. Kemudian ada a late poem, After the Pleasure Party, dia mengatakan ada hubungan yang ini, the dark vision, jadi pandangannya terhadap hubungan pria dan wanita yang cukup dark menurut dia. Trust men and they will be true to you. Nah, nanti kita akan lihat salah satu karyanya yang ada di dalam ini. Ini tapi kita akan masuk ke sesi kedua ya, setelah ini. Okay, I close this, and please join with me again in session two after this one. Okay? Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.